What's up? It's your boy Black C of that RBL Posse. You're tuned in to Thizzler. Subscribe below. Man, Cougnut was a big influence too. That's what, like I said, when we put out the Lesson to Be Learned album, or when we start working on it, we was trying to follow his footsteps. That's why we went to his studio, because he was cracking. Cougnut was the man when it came to the city. You know, that was, he was the top dog, you know what I mean? I'll say Forte too, because of the relationship with Too Short, and Tefo being part of the Dangerous Crew. And I had a tight relationship with Forte too. You know, a lot of people don't know that I was a big part of him getting with Ragtop Records and dealing with Frankie J and them up over there, because I was dealing with Frankie J, little brother Fly and all them, and kind of put that together. It's like a lot of stuff people don't know, you know what I mean, that I was a part of, even with JT the Bigger Figure with his album, first album coming out. I'm the one took JT to show him where to press his album up at, and took him out to Music Annex out in Hayward, like, bro, this is where you go do it, hook it up, you know, and all that. So a lot of people don't know, like, them little bitty details of, like, our relationships and stuff. But, yeah, Cougnut was that man when it came to the city, man. Like, when I got out of Log Cabin Ranch, man, in 89, he was the man. And like I said, once I went to the block, got with Budweiser, went and got the music, first thing I was doing, like, man, we got to go where Cougnut is going. And he like, man, I found out. And man, ain't nobody fucking with Cougnut when it comes to that fucking animation and the lyrics and how he does the storytelling, man. That boy was a beast. You know, he got choppers coming and Uzis going off and dogs barking. And man, the boy was dope, man. That was my guy, you know. But yeah, he was the man when it came to the city, man. He was like one of the first to, we feel was the first to really do it big, you know what I mean? Him and IMP, MC Fresh and them, man. And my dogs to this day, man. Me and C Fresh, man, that's my guy. Man, I'm proud of Young June, man. I ain't gonna lie, man. I liked him back then. I love him now too. But he has some shit that he got some shit right now that is, you know, because me and his daddy grew up together. That's like my best friend right now. I just was talking to him early this morning. That's my dude, Larry June. Well, OG Larry June. But yeah, Larry Jr., man, when he told me that his son was rapping and all that, man, and when he brought him to me, man, I was just like, man, this dude dope as hell. I got to get him on my album immediately. Man, the boy was hard, man. And he just, it's crazy how he just reinvented himself. He just switched it up, changed his name up a little bit. And now, man, like when I just did it, we did a show with him at Slim's a couple months ago, last year, man. They go bananas for him, man. The boy is a rock star, man. I love him to death, man. And I'm happy that I, you know, he considered me unk, you know what I mean? And I'm just proud of, like, him and his mom and his dad, like, we all grew up knee high, like, kids, like, been knowing each other for years. His grandfather, all of them, and Salim was one of the first rappers out of Hunters Point, his grandfather, like, you know what I mean? OG dude, you know what I mean? And had this famous line saying, we call it HP, but it's really Hunters Point. You know, like, he was like the main rapper out of Hunters Point back then. And he was a little jokester too, comedian, man, his grandpapa. But people don't know, we real tight. It's like, ain't no industry shit. Like, Young June is like family, real family. So, man, I'm proud of him. But yeah, a lot of people used to say he sounded like the young T.I. back when he first came out. He had a different type of, like, draw when he first came back from Atlanta. But yeah, he just reinvented himself, man, now. And man, I'm real proud of him, man. He doing real good, and he staying in his lane, you know what I mean? He ain't trying to chase nothing else. He know his demographic, he know his fan base, and he zeroed in over that. And that's all you got to do. Once you know it, you just gotta feed it. And that's kind of like where I'm doing, man. I know that Latino market, like, I know our demographic now, it's done changed over the years. So that's all I do is feed it. And I know, it's, you know, it's certain dudes like me, Selly Cell, Spice One, a lot of us, we share that same little space. And that's what we do. You know, we understand like a lot of the youngsters, the young, especially the young hipsters, the young black dudes and all that, the little hood dudes, they don't really fuck with it too much. They consider us OGs, old school, whatever you want to call it. But them Latinos dudes, man, from young to old, man, they fuck with us. And that's what we do. We feed that, we service that. We service them certain cities like them Salinas's and, you know, them Los Banos and, you know, them San Jose's and down in Los Angeles where the markets is real big, you know. And you could just eat just off that market, man, if you just zero in on that instead of trying to catch traction, trying to follow a Mozzie or trying to follow, you know, a SOB, RBE. You can't, you know your market, man, and feed it. And that's what I learned over the years, and that's why I'm successful now. You know what I mean? Whether people know it or not, you know, doing real good. I mean, only thing I could say is, man, to just keep, I mean, if you're serious about it, you just got to come in not thinking about the dollar figure, man, thinking about money, man. You got to do it out of the love. And sometimes it just happened to being at the right place at the right time, the right ears landing on it. I mean, that's why I say this internet stuff is really like, it's a gift and a curse, because you can really blow up nowadays real easy. No label, no nothing. It's real easy, but at the same time, it's hard. You know, the curse is that is everybody can do it. You know what I mean? And there's so many people doing it, ain't no fans no more. So you really got to stand out. So I say just keep grinding at it. That's why I respect my little cousin, H2MGAR, man, because he been staying at it, you know what I mean? He got a lot of members who was dealing with him, who might, they get motivated, then they get unmotivated, they get motivated, and it be like that, because I'm like that. You know, one minute I'm inspired, the next minute I'm just like, I ain't writing, I ain't doing nothing, I'm just doing shows, and, you know, it's an up and down thing, man. You just get unmotivated due to the, you know, you see the South doing their thing and it's the trap music. And it's like, I don't make that type of music. Then you see the youngsters coming out and it's like, damn, they making the type of shit we used to make. But they looking at us, if we do it, we too old, because we didn't really stay on the scene like a E-40 who didn't know how to reinvent himself and stay in their face, to where when he making adjustments, you ain't really noticing because he been staying out there. So if you off the scene and just like I say, I'm feeding my market, then I'm like, man, let me try to tap in and get these youngsters over here in the city or in the hood and really try to tap into that market and make music like how they make it and try to attract them. That's when you start looking stupid and start falling off and you start getting uninspired and you start getting discouraged and it's like, oh man, they ain't fucking with me. But you gotta stay at that shit. You gotta keep going, keep going, keep going. And one of them things might hit. You don't know when or where, but it just might just take the hell off. And you own now. Now you got a career. So it's kind of hard. I just say, if you love it, do it out of love. Stay doing it. And, you know, don't quit your day job. Just stay doing it. Make it a hobby and make it, like, you know, do it on your spare time. You know what I mean? And that's one thing about us. I always did it out of love. And I just now I'm able to get paid for it. You know what I mean? I wasn't planning on making money when I put it out. We just wanted people to have it and get it in their cars and wanted to hear people driving by playing it. And when that Bammer weed took off, man, it was just like off to the races. You know what I mean? And I turned it into a business, created a label, started finding new groups, start trying to put people out. And it's all about trying to put on some people too. You know what I mean? Because it might not be you. It might be your little cousin. It might be your brother. That's why, like, I fell back from producing. Herminator is like on the way up now. Him and Slapadelic is doing their thing. Sometimes you got to get out the way and let people, you know, get in that space and maybe, you know, H2MG take off. I might get inspired again and he might open up a lane for me to get on and drop a few verses and maybe drop an album, you know, drop a single and make something happen. But it's all about doing it out of love, man. That's all I say, man. And producers, you know, sometimes you might have to do a bunch of free stuff. You know, submit beats to them artists, give them, man, hey, use it for free. Don't get to trying to charge people $200, $500, and you ain't even got a name. If I could give Keek the Sneak or E-40 or somebody a beat for free, I'm going to do that just to get on. Because once it get on, you know, I might try to see if I can slide a little publishing up out of it, depending on who they is. If they, you know, on that major platform, try to get a little bit of publishing or something, because you will eat off that, you know what I mean, quarterly all through the year. Especially if it's somebody like a 40 or somebody and they putting out a single that's going platinum or an album that go platinum. You know, that's some money. But, yeah, it's just all about doing that shit out of love, man, and just having fun with it. You know what I mean? Don't get in there and make it a job where you're stressed out and, you know, you feel like, man, I got to make a hit. I got to, man, just make music, man. Go in there and make what you feel, whatever the vibe is, man. You in love right now? Fuck it, man. Make you a song about some female shit. If you hyphy and you juiced up, gassed up, you pimping or doing it, man, put that shit in music, man. Have fun with that shit. You know what I mean? That's what it's about, man, because music is all about that feeling anyway. You know what I mean? It's all about that energy that you're putting out through that. I ain't really ran into no challenges except for what I could say is really just getting talent to just kind of stay motivated and stay there and stay dedicated, man, because it's like I said, like I was saying before, artists, they get discouraged, man, and it's like you got to, it's like babysitting too a lot, man. Artists getting discouraged, or if they do a little good, they get big-headed, think they need a big check, and like, man, where my check at? And it's like, dude, we just got it out. You only sold like 5,000 units. I'm just now getting my money back. So it's like, it's really just dealing with the artist, man. That's the only problem, man, just the artist. As far as the business part, I mean, it's fun to me. I like it. I like dealing with like distribution companies going to have to, you know, make something happen with Walter, dealing with the promo companies, finding out, you know, putting together, you know, they little, maybe probably putting together little promo packages and, you know, getting stuff out to stores, getting them in the publications or whatever. Like, I don't mind doing all that as far as running a label, but, as far as the difficult part, the only difficult thing that I done ran into is really just dealing with artists and their egos, you know what I mean? Some of them being, like I said, a little too pumped, thinking they stars, and some of them be getting discouraged, and they might be talented, real talented, and they don't want to get in the studio because, I'm like, man, there ain't no money in this. I ain't feeling it now. And one minute they up, and one minute they down. So that was the big problem. The biggest problem I done had, and like I said before, I never really signed no artists. A lot of my artist deals and artists I dealt with was basically on handshakes, so they can walk at any time. And a lot of them did. They'd just get discouraged, and one minute they hear, I got 8 songs done, and invested a lot of money into mixing and mastering, and the next minute, nobody can find him. They like, oh man, he back working. He back at UPS. Or he back over here doing this. He don't want to do inch construction now. And it's like, you know, you can't recoup that now because he don't want to rap no more. And me, I'm not putting it out. If I got 8 songs from you and you ain't feeling it, I'm just going to trash it. I'm going to leave it on hard drive. So, you know, and I got a bunch of stuff that I'm sitting on from groups that I done dealt with, man, who was real talented, man, some dope dudes. And they just fell off the face of the fucking earth.